Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call to order the March 16th, 1999 meeting of the Planning Board of the Town of Cape Elizabeth. First item on the agenda is minutes of the previous meeting. Comments from the board. May I have a motion, please? We have a motion by Mr. Griffin.
Second.
Second by Mr. Parkhurst. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. Minutes are approved. Correspondence. In our packet, we received a letter from Mr. and Mrs. Pierce in regards to Hemlock Hill. Zoning news of February 1999. Planning Board goals for 1999. Notice of an open space workshop. On the podium this evening was a letter from David A. Laurie, attorney at law, regards to the Hemlock Hill subdivision amendments. A letter from Michael McGovern regarding the Hemlock Hill subdivision conditional municipal approval, an excerpt from the draft minutes of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council meeting held on March 10, 1999. A letter from Carolyn B. May in regard to Hemlock Hill's subdivision amendments. Information from Fitzpatrick Associates in regards to summary of lot sizes in the Oakhurst Road area by street. On the agenda this evening is a consent agenda. Three items. The first being the cookie jar de minimis site plan amendment. Second being 1235 Shore Road de minimis site plan amendment. And the third being Lamento Overden Highlands de minimis subdivision amendment. I'd like to ask the town planner to review each of these quickly, and then I'll await comments from the board.
What the board's done in the past with the consent agenda is these are supposed to be minor amendments to previously approved plans. If the board doesn't have any questions regarding the amendment, you can simply accept the consent agenda. However, there's an opportunity under each item for a board member to request that it be pulled off of the consent agenda and placed on the regular agenda. I'd just like to go through the three items very quickly because there have been a couple of last minute changes. Under the cookie jar, this was a site plan that the board approved just recently, and it included an addition to the rear of the building and also a paved concrete pad. The applicant is requesting that a portion of the pad be used to support an additional 8x10 addition to the building. The exterior treatment is going to be compatible to the addition that the board recently approved. On the 1235 Shore Road de minimis change, that's a proposal by Linda and Everett Johnson to add a garage. The board approved the site plan in 1993 with a garage on it. The garage was never constructed. The applicants would like to change the location of the garage. They'd also like to change the alignment of the parking. And third, under Blumenthal Ovenden, that is a case where there's a building envelope on an approved lot, and it appears after the fact that the building, in fact, is not entirely within the building envelope. The applicants have submitted a revised building envelope, and there was a request made by a planning board member that building envelope at least be tied down. The reason I'm bringing that up is because the applicants this afternoon actually just gave me a plan that provides two distance points from the corners of the building to the property line with a dimensional standard. So that may address that issue, and I'd be glad to put that plan up so everyone can see it. Are there any questions?
Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion.
Excuse me. Before Mr. Parkhurst makes it, I wanted to bring two of these items off the agenda.
For discussion,
at least. I can do that after Mr. Parkhurst makes his motion, but I would like...
I believe it may be conflicting if you allow them to do that, so...
Okay, why don't I just raise the issues? First issue is the one that Maureen has just brought up, is the issue of our approving on the consent agenda. Let me preface by saying I have nothing substantially, I have no substantial issues with either one of these applications. My comments are not going to prohibit them from being approved. But I just wanted, for the public record and for the planning board's information and my own enlightenment and perhaps others, is dealing with the issue of building envelope, is that we have two plans in front of us, neither one of which has a single dimension bearing or any other information that describes the building envelope. And as you can easily see, this plan was approved some time ago, and for anyone on this board, we have no idea why this envelope was described the way it is or delineated the way it is on the plan. I happened to have served on the board at the time that this project was approved. So I called Maureen earlier so that just to give her a heads up so no one would be blindsided by this. I would like to see the house tied down in such a way that it can be figured out where it is on the face of the earth. And without dimensions on the building or some other overall dimension, what we typically end up with is we end up with a single corner tied to two property lines. We never can, the building can rotate in free space. What we need is a triangulation that will lock the building on the lot. And then I also requested that at least that portion of the building that appears to be in violation or the building envelope be given a dimension away from the building face so that at least the present owner knows if they go out and do something, if they add a small addition in the future, whether or not they're within that building envelope. And lastly, the plan that we have indicates that the building envelope falls within a 30-foot water easement, which I don't believe is correct. So if those three things can be dealt with, then I certainly would be pleased to make those conditions of approval. And I guess my concern to the board would be that when we approve building envelopes in the future, that we look very closely at what we're approving. It's very easy to look at side yard setbacks, easements, drainage ways, and all of those things that are defined on the face of the earth and that can be put on a plat plan. But if we have a building envelope that is tied to, for example, an RP1 wetland setback or an RP2 setback, somehow that setback line should be defined on the face of the earth, because I don't know how the code enforcement officer can enforce these lines if there's no way of finding them other than to scale them off a plan, which is the first rule of construction, is one never does that. So shall I deal with these together, or?
You can continue if you like, Mr. Emery. Okay.
On the Everett Johnson, I think the design of the garage addition is very nice. The Johnsons, as they say in their cover letter, were one of the first applicants to come before the board after the town center ordinance had been adopted, and the concept of shared parking and all the rest, I think, is something that we'd hope that everybody else would emulate. My only concern is that to be sure that the applicant is fully aware of where this parking lot that's proposed in the back is going to end up. And I took the rare time, I guess, to take the architect's plan and transpose it onto the site plan, and there appears to be a conflict between at least what the planner's understanding is that the parking in the back wouldn't shift. My best guess, and again, this is a fairly, I use engineer scale, but it appears as though the parking is going to be some number of feet closer to that rear property line, and probably you would end up having to fill a couple of feet there. So I have no trouble whatsoever approving the garage addition. I just think before as a condition of approval that the code enforcement officer and the planner are satisfied that if there is filling required, that it's done within the property line, or that a retaining wall be shown if that's indeed possible to have given the setback requirement for structure.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Mr. Parker, you had a motion?
I think I refer to Mr. Emery since he's made some conditions. I think you probably make the motion.
Any further discussion from the board?
Do you have the motion there?
Mm-hmm. Right here.
Thank you. Would any of the applicants care to come to the podium and identify themselves by name and address and address these concerns of Mr. Emery? Right ahead, sir.
Good evening. My name is Everett Johnson. I come before you for the 1235 Shore Road site plan amendment. I understand what Mr. Emery is talking about is the northern boundary of the parking area. What we did after we talked with Bruce and Maureen is we extended the aisle from 22 feet to 24 feet in the plan. So that is an adjustment that we did make in the amendment that wasn't in the site plan, but we did feel that was a minor change. We've gone off and paced off the distance from the garage to the back end of the parking area, and we think there's plenty of room there before the gradients drop off the cliff there that goes down probably 6 or 8 feet. So we're confident that that we can put the parking in there and it will fit. There's been absolutely no erosion since 1993, and there is quite a drop-off there. The plan is to put parking stops and a fence along that back area, and we think there's plenty of room with 24 feet. If we had to review this in further detail, we do have that. We've been told that 22 feet to 24 feet is the aisle definitions that you're looking for, and that might be an area that we could sort of work within. So that's my only comment.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you. Again, it's a very lovely design. I mean, I have no issue with the proposal. I think it's a wonderful concept. The circulation all seems to work well. If you were to narrow it to 22 feet, given the larger vehicles that people tend to drive, you're really at your own risk. The corner of the garage, as you know, it might be susceptible to some damage. But let me go ahead and make the motion, and I'll try to put some...
If I may interrupt, Mr. Emery, the representatives from the Cookie Jar, I believe, would like to come forward. Please do.
Hi, I'm Don Nichols. This is Holly Overton. We're not okay. Representing the Cookie Jar. We're recommending the Blumenthal Overtons at lot number 4, the Highlands. It was brought to my attention a couple of weeks ago when they did a mortgage survey that this building was supposedly 15 feet outside of what Mr. Emery has determined as a vague building envelope. I agree with you 100%. We did go back to Owen Haskell, the original designer of the subdivision. He did redefine the building envelope this afternoon after talking to Maureen that we had a problem and wanted to get it tied. I talked to him at 3:30 this afternoon, and he did tie three corners of the building to the property lines to meet your request.
Okay.
You know, as a general contractor, I can't agree with you more that these building envelopes, if they were defined with measurements off the property lines, it would make my job a heck of a lot easier. The designer of the house had laid the lot out. We've got stakes to go by. It was dug. There's the lot line is 85 feet from where the corner of the house is. And then all of a sudden, 7 months later, they're saying we've violated this vague building envelope. So that's what our position is. Any questions?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Emery?
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that the consent agenda be approved with the following conditions. One, under 1235 Shore Road site plan amendment, that the owner confirm with the code enforcement officer that no additional fill will be required to construct the rear parking lot. And on item 3, the Blumenthal Overton Highlands subdivision amendment, that the plan be amended to show offsets to the adjacent property lines to the building and an offset from the building to the revised building envelope.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Masterton. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. The consent agenda is approved. First item under old business is the Tinsman Retail Building Addition. You notice in your packet a memo requesting that this matter be tabled. Any discussion from board members? May I have a motion, please? Thank you, David. I have a motion that, would you like to read that motion, David?
It'd be a lot helpful.
Be it ordered that based on the plans, materials submitted, the facts presented, the application of Tom Tinsman for site plan review of Arabin Center Retail Office Apartment Project located adjacent to the existing building located at 349 Ocean House Road be tabled to the regular April 20, 1999 Planning Board meeting.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. It is unanimous. Second item under old business, St. Bartholomew Church site plan. The representatives, please come forward.
Mr. Chairman and board members, good evening. My name is John Decro. I reside at 12 Saltsbury in Cape Elizabeth. I'm a member of St. Bartholomew's Parish and also serve as the Facility Planning Committee Chairman. Tonight joining me is Father Michael Henschel, the pastor of the parish, Dennis Lemieux, and Andy D. Hayes of Harriman Associates, the architect. In addition, there are numerous parishioners here tonight also for the public hearing. We're here tonight to request approval of the site plan for the renovation and addition of St. Bartholomew's Church as detailed in the Planning Board submission dated January 29, 1999. In subsequent correspondence, there are a couple comments that Mr. Lemieux will address from the technical standpoint. I will just turn the meeting over to him and let you ask any questions he has that you have of him. Thank you.
If I may, as Chairman, just interrupt for just a minute. Mr. McNichols has stepped down from the podium for this item on the agenda only. Please go ahead, sir.
Oh, thank you. Because there was no changes has been made to the proposed site plan since our last submission, we feel the submission is complete, and we respectfully request the Planning Board's approval. But we're here tonight to answer any questions that you may have in reference to the submission.
Thank you. At this time, I'd like to open the public hearing on this article. Anyone present this evening that would like to comment on the St. Bartholomew Church site plan, please come forward to the podium. Identify yourself by name and address.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman. For the benefit of people at home, is there a site plan that we can hang up?
Yes.
Assuming there are people at home watching, of course.
Once again, are there any members of the public who would like to come forward? Not seeing a mad rush to the podium, the public hearing is now closed. I'd like to open it for discussion of the members of the board. Please, Nancy.
Have we resolved the problem regarding the light pole and the trees, possible conflict in the islands? Have we resolved that?
I believe that at the last submission, the discussion was that a member of the board felt that the light levels were low, and we felt that at that time, and we still do today, that the light levels meet the requirement of the IES standards. We submitted for this meeting this evening other calculations showing what would happen if the poles were lowered at 15 foot, and we would have to put a series of possibly up to 8 light poles to accomplish the light levels requirement. And therefore, we felt that the way we had submitted it, with the poles being at 25 feet, is the most prudent way of doing it. And I'm on the impression that that is being approved.
But wasn't there the suggestion, at least, that there should be a tree planted on each of the islands where the poles are, or at least two of them?
There was a suggestion made to that, but the ordinance is pretty clear that we're not in that part of town. We're in the residential A district, not in the downtown district. I'm not sure what the correct terminology is, but we're not in that district where that requirement is, where that is a requirement. We meet the ordinance for this residential A requirement.
Is that true, Marie?
In the town center district, it is a requirement. However, you can require it in other districts as part of the landscaping requirement under site plan review. Does that make sense?
Yes. Well, I was going to suggest using a yew or something, a big shrub, instead of a tree. But if the tree is no longer an issue, let's forget it.
Mr. Parkhurst?
Let's see. M, exterior lighting, page 3. There's an unanswered question here whether or not the lighting will be turned off between 11 o'clock and 6 a.m. I guess the tomb lights at the church themselves. Has that been determined one way or another?
I see no problems with the parish having those lights turned off at that time. It's an energy consideration, which I think there's no activities usually at that time. You want to answer that, Father?
The only time now those lights are left on is when I forget to turn the switch off. And and it would certainly be in our best interest not to have them on. So I would hope that they'd be timed, and I think we can certainly do that so that they'd absolutely be off at that time. Yes.
Thank you.
Other comments? Mr. Emery.
Just a couple of questions. Did you write the letter that stated February 26th? The cover letter to Maureen?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Perhaps, I think, for the benefit of the public, and I think the issue, as I understand it, is that there was some concern raised as to the height of the poles with respect to the adjacent residential neighborhood, that the higher the poles get, the more commercial the parking lot looks. And as a way of addressing that, we were asking for you to look at shorter poles. The concern then became, as demonstrated in the material that you've submitted, that in order to do lower poles or shorter poles, there have to be additional light levels, poles, because the light doesn't, although it's brighter at the ground, it doesn't distribute as far. That's one of the issues. I think the other issue was this idea of breaking up the parking lot with additional landscape islands at the bottom of the site. Driving here this evening, I just sort of looked to my left to see how the Methodists were handling this situation, so to speak, and their parking lot their parking lot is only illuminated at the perimeter near the church. It's not, doesn't have an interior lighting at all. Certainly this town and the planning board has fairly strict site plan standards. I see a situation like this, as long as the poles aren't unusually tall. I guess what, first of all, I'd like to know is if the pole is 25 feet or if the mounting height of the pole is 25 feet. If it ends up on a 3 or 4 foot tall concrete base, is it the fixed, the mounting height is...
And mounting height will be at 25
feet. It'll be at 25 feet, okay. And it appears from your diagrams that really what you're trying to explain to the planning board is that your proposal is a balance between trying to come up with a reasonable light level and trying to keep the costs of the project within a reasonable budget. And my guess would be that if we were to look at one of these other options with the shorter poles and the additional number of poles, we would tend to get a brighter sense that the parking lot as a whole would look much brighter than it would with the taller poles with fewer lights?
The light levels would probably be similar, but there would be considerably a lot more lights, per se. The wattage may be reduced so that the spread would be not as bright on the ground, but there would certainly be, there would be a minimum of 8 poles versus 4 poles.
I think the real test of this, as long as the proposal is not unreasonable, is that the test is between the engineer, the architect, and the congregation, so to speak. The more, at some point, the, you know, I don't know what the age distribution is of the congregation or if the, what the time of day the congregation meets. I know there's certainly the building, as the chairman had mentioned, last meeting is used very frequently off hours, that there are early morning services that's dark. I guess what I would prefer to do, I think it would be wonderful if the lights weren't too tall. On the other hand, if we end up with too many lights that are shorter and they create hot spots on the ground so you get a much brighter sense there, I don't know that we've really achieved much. So I feel, I guess, comfortable with the information you've submitted, and I would leave it to you and the congregation and the building committee that you're satisfied that the safety issues of anyone using the facilities are being met, that there aren't dark spots, there aren't blind spots in the critical areas. I do take exception with a comment in your letter regarding, I certainly understand the issues of budget and wattages and trying to keep down the total wattages so that you don't kick in the higher level of service and requirement and so forth. But in terms of adding an island to help define the parking and to add additional shade within the parking lot, you say would not help the appearance. That's near the bottom on the front page. I don't agree with that. Again, I think the proposal is really between you and the congregation, the sort of what you want, how you want the front door of the church to look. Again, I know that there are limited budgets and the buildings tie up a lot of that money. There's certainly, I think, a lot of landscaping in the project. There's islands, so nobody forgets, there are islands all along the upper portion of the parking lot that have trees in them. So I don't have an issue with the total number of trees. If it were possible, if that seems to have an improvement in terms of the definition of the parking lot and the layout of the parking lot, given the number of spaces, to have another, at least toward the front of the parking lot, to have two more islands with trees, and if those islands had to be curbed with Cape Cod bituminous curb rather than granite, I wouldn't have an issue with that. The parking lot behind Town Hall has a single light in each island, and there are two trees that are, I think they're linden trees, not ash trees as you're proposing, but that helps to define that parking area, and I think that's sort of the goal that the planning board was talking about. I'm not going to deny the project based on the plan submitted, but I personally believe it would be an improvement to have an additional island at least toward the front of the parking lot if the budget is an issue.
Mr. Parkhurst.
In your letter also, there's a mention of pedestrian easement. Have you heard from the diocese yet as to whether or not they're in favor of that?
I indicated to Maureen in a discussion last week that both the parish and the diocese are more than willing to provide for such an easement. At this point, the issue right now is getting the surveyors out there to do the surveying that needs to be done and getting the work done to get it drawn onto the plan and know exactly what we're defining. But we've basically agreed with in principle to do it, and we've agreed with the general area where it's going to be. It's being able to get calls back from surveyors who are very busy at this time and getting it done. But we feel very confident that it can get done. It's just going to be a matter of when the surveyors can get out there and get the work done that needs to be done in order to be able to get this signed off and get the lawyers to all approve it.
Thank you.
Mr. Wilcox.
I have one question regarding the site plan, in that the no dumpster is depicted on the site plan. I believe something was said along those lines earlier, but could you just tell us what the plans for trash accumulation and removal are and whether or not a dumpster is sort of envisioned for the property?
Currently, the solid waste is picked up on twice a week from the janitor and brought to the dump directly. So there's no need for the dumpster on the site.
Thank you.
Any further questions from the board? I'd like to ask for a motion. Mr. Parkhurst?
Motion for the board to consider. Findings of fact, number one, St. Bartholomew's Church is proposing an addition and a parking lot expansion as part of an overall renovation project which requires site plan review. Number two, the site supports significant existing vegetation which is expected to remain to buffer the final project. Number three, the town engineer has recommended revisions to the plan in his letter dated 2/5/99. Number four, the application substantially complies with Section 19-9 site plan regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of St. Bartholomew's Church for site plan review of a building addition and parking lot expansion located at 8 Two Lights Road be approved with the following condition. Number one, that a note be added to the plan requiring existing vegetation depicted on the plans and not located within the construction area to be preserved. Number two, that the plans be revised per the town engineer's letter dated 2/5/99. And three, that there be no alteration of the site nor building permit issued until the above conditions have been met.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion by board members? Mr. Emery?
Is there any need to tie the pedestrian easement to a condition?
Maureen?
I would recommend that we keep this a voluntary offering by the applicant.
Thank you.
Further discussion by board members? All those in favor of the motion as proposed, please raise your right hand. All those opposed? Carries unanimously. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is the Hemlock Hill subdivision amendments. I'd like to ask the applicant and their staff to present a quick overview of about 3 to 5 minutes, and then I will open the public hearing.
Good Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Thank you for hearing us tonight. My name is Owens McCullough. I'm a civil engineer with the firm of Sebago Technics here tonight on behalf of Joel and Kelly Fitzpatrick. Also with me tonight, if the board has questions, is Mark Hampton, our soil scientist and wetlands delineator for the company. I'll make it a very brief introduction, and once that's closed, or once you have the public hearing, if you have any questions or would like some follow-up, we'd be glad to try to answer any questions. I certainly appreciate the board's time and the public for joining us on the site walk this past Saturday. The weather was cooperative, fortunately. Again, we're here tonight for an amended subdivision. This subdivision was originally approved back in 1964 and again in 1972. We're also here for a resource protection permit to locate some utilities to cross a 100-foot RP1 wetland buffer and for the disturbance of approximately 900 square feet of wetland area associated with a roadway. The project, again, is 6.5 acres in size, 13 lots. It was originally 19 lots. We're reducing the number of lots by combining some of them. The roadway, as we discussed on the site walk and at the last meetings, we're proposing to adjust the location of the roadway, leaving the lots as they were originally, except for combining some of those lots. The project will be served by public water and sewer. The applicant, of course, has recognized the importance of this project, and we'd like to extend our appreciation to the staff and Public Works Director and to the town engineer for working with us as we develop this plan. Tonight, if appropriate after the public hearing is done, what we would hope to do is move forward with the final plans, hopefully coming back in April for final approval on the project. After tonight, once we hear the comments from the board and the public, we will be resubmitting very shortly. We've been working on addressing the town engineer's review comments. They're of a technical nature. They don't really change the overall design of the project. We worked very closely with him so that we would come up with a concept that worked well with the site. So we will be filing that information after tonight, incorporating any other comments the board has. With that said, I will close my initial presentation. And again, Joel and Kelly are here. I myself and Mark Hampton would be glad to answer any questions the board has. I did bring a color rendering of the site for representation if anybody wants to look at it. And with that, I'll step down. Thank you.
Thank you, Owen. At this time, I'd like to open a public hearing. Request by Fitzpatrick Associates for amendments to the previously approved subdivision, a resource protection permit, and private accessway permit located at the end of Hemlock Hill Road and Woodcrest Road, Section 16-2-5, amendments to a previously approved subdivision, Section 19-8-3, a resource protection permit, and Section 19-7-9, private accessway permit. Public hearing is now open. Those members of the public who wish to speak, please come forward to the podium and identify yourself by name and address, please.
My name is Myron Reed. I live at 5 Rockwall Lane, and the property that I own is immediately across Oakhurst Avenue or Road from this property right here. I bring up last October 10th, 1998, when we had a very severe rainstorm. And about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I found that raw sewage was backing up from the town sewer into the lower floor of my house. The lower floor is completely finished off. It is living space. It is not a basement or a cellar. It is living space with bedrooms and bathroom and living room that are all finished off. Naturally, I was very concerned, and so I immediately went out and in the pouring rain to see where what was happening to the sewer system. The sewer system for this area consists of a sump that all of the sanitary sewers from this area drain into. there are two pumps in this sump, and they go on automatically by the level of the water. If there isn't much inflow, only one pump would be running. If there is more inflow, the second pump comes on. These pumps pump into the sewer system, which eventually, of course, ends up down in Knightville. Well, I went out to see what was the matter, and I walked down Oakhurst Road, and water, surface water, was flowing across Oakhurst Road into the waterway on the south side of Oakhurst Road. And then I walked over to the top of this sanitary sewer sump, and water, surface water, covered the top of this sump. And so I contacted the town people, and I was assured that the reason for the backup into my cellar was due to the surface water. It was not due to any failure of the sanitary sewer system. The sanitary sewer system, I was told, was overloaded by the surface water. Well, that all seemed logical to me. So, but this subdivision is going to put more sanitary sewage into the system, and it's going to create probably more surface water drainage than we had before. And I would ask the planning board to ask the developer what, how he is going to guarantee that the surface water is not going to rise above the top of the sanitary sewage sump. There needs to be something done about that. There used to be ponds in this area, but due to erosion and so on, they've gradually filled up over the years, so the ponds are not doing much of a job. I also have a question. I looked at some of the papers concerning this, and I feel that the reason the water was crossing Oakhurst pavement to get across from the north side to the south side was because the culvert, which is underneath the road, was overloaded. Well, I discovered upon looking on their plans that they intend to reduce the size of this culvert, which is presently 16 inches in diameter, to a 15-inch diameter culvert. And this, I think, is absolutely the wrong thing to do. I think the culvert should be increased to, say, like 24 inches in diameter to assure us that the culvert can handle the surface water that comes down into this area and convey it across underneath Oakhurst to the creek on the other side, which feeds into wetlands that are over here. So I have two requests of you. One, to see what they are going to do to limit the height that the surface water inflow rises to in cases of heavy rainfall. And the other is to do something about this culvert underneath Oakhurst that they intend to reduce in size rather than increase it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reed. Podium is open.
My name is Chip Stockford. I live at 5 Cape Woods Drive, and I'm here representing the Cape Woods Condominium Association, which is located to the north of the project. This association is composed of 22 units, and when it was constructed during the early 90s, there was considerable concern over water problems in the area. At that time, holding areas were built within the project perimeters. In addition, some of the buildings were required to have their foundations raised when they came before the planning board at that time. And each unit was required to have a sump pump. Well, naturally, when we heard of the proposal adjacent to our property that would apparently increased tremendously the water flow in our direction and also the potential of erosion because of filling, particularly on lots 5, 6, and 7, we were concerned. And as a result of that, of our reservations, we employed John Tuohy, who is a hydrologic engineer, who I would like to have speak at this time. Mr. Tuohy.
Good evening. I'm John Tuohy. I'm president of Tuohy Associates, an environmental consulting firm in South Portland. The subjects I want to talk about tonight, and I will be brief, have to do with water and erosion. I have been retained by the Cape Woods subdivision, and the Cape Woods subdivision and the Hemlock Hill subdivision are linked, and they are linked by water because this wetland occurs between the two subdivisions, and that wetland is used to capture water from both of the subdivisions. I know it is important to, I know that the two subdivisions are linked by water because Sebago Technics has modeled the runoff from Cape Woods as part of their project. When they did that modeling of where all the runoff goes in a 25-year storm at Cape Woods, they found that their model says that when that happens, there's an overflow down on Oakhurst. In their report, as they address that, they say the potential condition, that is an overflow at the culvert crossing, is a pre-existing condition and unrelated to the proposed Hemlock Hill subdivision. And in fact, they use modeling to understand how runoff goes in both subdivisions, but when they got an unfavorable result with respect to the Cape Woods water, they did not go back to understand why that may be the case and to try to bring understanding to it. Cape Woods was a challenging subdivision with respect to water, and they took extraordinary means to deal with their water. Some of those means, such as dry wells filled with permeable material to collect water, may be temporal in nature. They may have a potential to clog up over time. If that were the case, then all of the water that in the model overflows Oakhurst Road could happen in the future. They've done a model, they got results that were perplexing to them, they chose to ignore that, and I think they should be asked to go back in and understand that water situation better. The second item deals with sediment and erosion control, and in particular on these lots, which was formerly Lot 5, which has been subdivided into Lot 5 and 6. On the plan that I got from the file at the planning department, there is a slope on that former Lot 5 that drops 19 feet over 50 feet. The head wall at Sugarloaf drops about 22 feet over 50 feet. The steepness of that slope is about the same as the head wall at Sugarloaf and much steeper than the rest of Sugarloaf Mountain. That is a very steep slope that may be an unbuildable lot, coupled with the fact that the soils there are shallow soils over bedrock. If we have a slope that is that steep, if we have soils that are prone to erosion, and the during construction, it says in the stormwater report that if a area is going to be, it can be open for 14 days without having erosion control devices on it. I think that is a routine criteria that has been applied to an extraordinary situation, which is the steepness of that lot and the nature of the soils on that lot. If people are going to be living in that type of terrain, that very steeply sloping terrain, there's a potential, a strong potential, for garden material from lawn material to eroding into the wetland and interfering with the operation of that wetland and interfering with the operation of the very important stream that leads from the site. I think there was one big lot. It's been subdivided into two lots. I think, in fact, that one big lot could well be considered an unbuildable lot. During the site walk, the developer says, I haven't figured out what to do with those. Those lots are a challenge, and I think they are indeed a challenge, and I think that they need to be looked at much more carefully than what they have been looked at. This is an extraordinary piece of terrain in which to build, and the fact that two subdivisions were approved there previously and have not been built may be because it's a challenging terrain. It's going to be expensive to build that, and I think the developer is going to have a challenge and needs to have the financial capability to deal with what is a very challenging lot. In summary, they've ignored some data that they've got here. That data should be incorporated. These two lots have an extraordinary steepness to them in erodible soils. They may not be a buildable lot, and the whole site is a substantial challenge. And it's going to be a challenge financially, I'm sure, to the developer. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there another speaker?
My name is David Laurie. I'm an attorney, and I live at 189 Spurwink Avenue in Cape Elizabeth. I'm here representing the Woodcrest neighborhood, which is over here, slightly off the map. It's kind of unfortunate that it's off the map because a lot of the problems of this project happen off of there, off site. And I wrote you a letter, which is dated March 12th, which I believe the chairman indicated you had received. I have additional copies here if people need it or if anybody in the audience wants to see it. The letter identifies three issues. The principal ones, though, are the requirement of the site plan ordinance as to minimum lot size, which differs from the requirements of the zoning ordinance as to minimum lot size. Minimum lot size under the subdivision ordinance, because subdivisions are supposed to upgrade existing zoning, is that lots in the subdivision, every one of those lots is required to conform to the underlying zoning. Being a lawful non-conforming lot under the underlying zoning is not enough. It has to actually conform, and in this zone, that means these lots have to each be 20,000 square feet. And I would submit, and I'm not going to take much more time on this issue. If the board has questions, I can tell you, you know, how we got there if you didn't understand it from my letter. But I submit that this plan is not approvable in its present form because of the minimum lot size requirements, which simply are not met. There are lots proposed which are less than 20,000 square feet, and it's not approvable as such. The road standards are perhaps the biggest concern of the neighborhood that I represent, and they share some of the concerns over water as well, and that's not in my letter, but individual members of the neighborhood have told me that, and they're going to be here tonight to tell you that. But the fact is that the traffic problems associated with the link to Woodcrest Road are the most significant issue for my clients. Not the only issue, but certainly the most significant. And it's submitted that those that connection does not meet the requirements of the subdivision ordinance. Subdivision ordinance requires that there be a safe connection, that the intersection, the access, be safe from a traffic standpoint. And I have a letter which I just got today from William Bray. Mr. Bray was the traffic engineer in the city of Portland for many, many years, and he's presently the director of public works in the city of Portland. And he's testified in a number of cases in court and before boards. I believe he's been before this board a number of times in connection with site plans in the town. And Mr. Bray's opinion is that the vertical site distance along Woodcrest Road, and if you stand at the corner of Orchid and you look up Woodcrest, you look up the hill, you'll see that that vertical site distance is completely unacceptable. This intersection here, this distance right here, is according to Mr. Bray, who says that he has carefully measured the intersection site distance along that area. That intersection site distance is approximately 125 feet. Mr. Bray says that the minimum site distance, and in his letter, which I will pass out in a moment, in his letter he goes through three standards. He doesn't deal with the AASHTO standards, which are similar to each of these three standards that he does deal with in the letter. The minimum standard varies from between 200 feet and 250 feet. And that's assuming a car going at only 20 miles per hour. And he has looked at that area and he said traffic there generally travels about 20 miles per hour. I think that's everybody's experience. He's computed down the site distance based upon the 20 mile per hour that you would expect at that intersection and along that street, and still finds that it's approximately half, significantly less than what's required. I'll just read his conclusion for the record. The measured site distance looking east from the proposed subdivision intersection with Woodcrest Road is considerably less than the minimum standard. I would strongly suggest that the planning board require the developer to submit revised design plans that demonstrate that the minimum site distances can be provided. Now, I frankly don't think that the developer can ever do that, because this is a public street. This is actually outside the subdivision. The problem already exists, and now they're proposing to put an intersection in there which will add traffic from 11 homes right out here coming out this way when traffic is coming up the hill there, and the vertical site distance is just 125 feet according to Mr. Bray, and it doesn't work. This is a dangerous intersection. And it cannot be allowed under the ordinance, and you should not allow it because it is, in fact, dangerous. What we need, I think, is a recognition here that the protection of this neighborhood, particularly as to traffic, far outweighs the savings that this developer would accomplish in terms of the loss of wetlands. And what we have is the potential for a savings of wetlands. That's why I've been told over and over again the developer needs to come out on Woodcrest Road. Well, that the sacrifice of this neighborhood for that wetland is just not acceptable. It's not allowed under the ordinance. The fact that this might be a better project in terms of wetlands because the developer proposes to come out on Woodcrest as opposed to coming out on Oakhurst does not make it acceptable under the ordinance, when in fact the traffic onto Woodcrest does not work, and it simply does not work. I'm going to pass out Mr. Bray's letter for you. I have additional copies for the developer and the audience.
Mr. Lurie, if I could have those. And
sure.
Reason why we're doing it this way is when we have information presented to the board, it goes first to the planner's office and it'll be reviewed if necessary by other department heads within the town as well, and then submitted with their comments to each member of the board. But we will all receive these.
And I apologize, I would have given you earlier, but as you can see from the facts, it was sent to me today.
Not a problem. It's the way we keep ourselves educated, because we're not engineers.
Well, to be very candid, if you stand, you don't have to be a traffic engineer, just like you don't have to be a weatherman to know when it's raining. If you stand down at Orchid Road and look up, you can see what the problem is. And it is vertical site distance, and I don't think it's solvable. It's certainly not proposed to be solved today.
Thank you, Mr. Laurie. Podium is open. Sir, please, come right forward.
Thank you. My name is George Stevens, and I live at 10 Woodcrest Road with my family, my wife Pam, and my three children. 10 Woodcrest Road is, my home is approximately, well, that might be the footprint of it right there. My property boundary is less than 100 feet from the boundary of the subdivision, and my property is probably 200 feet from this proposed entrance to Bellwood Road. Obviously, I have some feelings about this subdivision, but I'm here mostly to speak on behalf of my children, Gretchen, age 3, Jackson, age 5, and Natalie, age 6. They've entrusted me to protect their safety and their quality of life, and I oppose the subdivision to both of those ends. First of all, on a natural resource ecological basis, this is occurring in a wooded area in our backyard that my children cherish. They get great pleasure from watching the wildlife, coyote, fox, deer, pileated woodpecker, the kinds of things that for me are important about living in Maine. This would essentially decimate, as those of you who walk the site plan could see the topography there, to make it buildable would require it to essentially be decimated and flattened out. In terms of safety, I have huge concerns about, as the attorney just said, the flow of traffic coming off this almost right angle at the base of the hill. The traffic of whatever it is, 12 houses, between service industries, homeowners traffic, whatever it may be. Our lots here are very, very small. We have little, if any, front yard. And essentially, Woodcrest Road is like a glorified cul-de-sac. There's no through traffic. Simply, the only people who drive on it are its residents. And because of the size of our lots, our children, my three, my neighbor's three, they're probably in the 10 houses that occupy this portion of Woodcrest Road, there probably are over 20 children. Our play spills right out into Woodcrest Road regularly. My children and I walk this corner every morning to take my six-year-old to the bus. This hill this morning was barely negotiable by foot because of its iciness. God forbid one of my neighbor's teenage friends should come over the hill, or a teenager from one of these guests not knowing what's ahead of them. I really fear for the safety of my children. To me, it seems ludicrous to run the risk, and frankly, I'm incensed that for profit and gain, my children's safety might be jeopardized. To plug this this road out here on Woodcrest, to me, seems like a hazard to both the quality of life and the safety of my children and my neighbor's children, and I implore you to look very carefully at what you approve. I'm not a lawyer, but what I read also was a hope to waive some kind of neighborhood impact valuation, and I think that would be a big mistake. I think we really need to look closely at not only the effects of this on the environment and the wetlands, but on this neighborhood next door. And I'm really, it's a really sad because it's become kind of a divisive issue. Fran Bell is a lovely and dear neighbor of ours, and I certainly have no problem and applaud her in trying to, you know, sell this property and provide for her own family. But at the same time, I'm very scared about the impact it's going to have on my children. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stevens. Sir, in this corner, you were standing before.
Uh,
This seems like a very minor problem.
Sir, if you could identify yourself, please.
My name is Richard Cohen.
Thank you.
And I live at 5 Hemlock Hill Road. And the land that we have and the home that we have abuts one of the lots which Mr. Fitzpatrick intends to erect a building on. And in order to save some time, my first question would be is whether or not you received a letter from me of February 12th. When you read off the list of letters, you did not show that you had one.
You would have gotten it last month.
We had it as part of our record at last month's meeting, sir.
You did?
Yes, sir.
I have it right here.
Yep.
Oh, all right. Then shall I go on?
By all means.
Okay. In the letter, I asked, one, on behalf of my wife, Arla, and me, that the culvert which crosses our land behind our home and which goes to the corner of lot number one, that culvert will not be removed or altered by the builder or future owners. That's extremely important to us. We are very much concerned about any backup of water, especially since I just built an office in the basement, and which I use all the time. And secondly, I had asked that the buffer between the property line and the building envelope be maintained by the builder. And I had talked to Ms. O'Mara about this, and we have seen the plan. So my concern is for children as and the concerns that people on Woodcrest have, but I also have to be a little bit selfish in this and look out for our home and what we consider may be a problem. And I believe that Mr. Fitzpatrick, from what I know, is willing to honor that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cohen. Podium is open.
Good evening. My name is Libby DeMille. I live at 4 Woodcrest Road. My husband and I own two lots of land between Woodcrest Road and Oakhurst Road, directly abutting what is shown as Lot 8 on the subdivision plan. And so our house would be the closest one to the proposed new road called Bellwood Drive. I'd like to say that one of the reasons we chose to live here and why we enjoy it so much today is that it's very peaceful and quiet, hardly any traffic on our side of the Woodcrest Road loop. Generally, the households on the southwestern half of the loop here travel out to Oakhurst Road this way. The people on the northeastern part travel out this way via Orchid Road. So, basically, only about 4 households travel past our road today, our house today. If this new road is built, all the vehicles coming and going from the proposed subdivision during the construction phase and afterwards would all be going right past our house. If you assume 2 cars per household, this would mean the disturbance of about 22 additional vehicles going by every day. At night, this would mean that the headlights would be shining right into our dining room window of people going out Bellwood Drive. So, in addition to the disturbance created by the additional traffic, the anticipated clear-cutting of trees, blasting of rock ledge, and extensive digging and filling that will be required to build this new road will be very difficult for us to endure. Of primary importance, however, is my concern, as Mr. Stevens was saying, about safety on Woodcrest Road because of the inadequate site distance. Our driveway comes right out on the crest of that steep hill that has been mentioned. The hill slopes down in one direction quite steeply to where the Bellwood Drive intersection would be proposed to come out, and then quite steeply in the other direction down to Orchid Road. And I'm sure many of us have slipped and slid many times trying to come to a stop at that intersection. If you're driving up the hill in either direction, you can't see a car coming from the other way until one of you crests the hill. And fortunately, there's so little traffic today on that side of the Woodcrest Road loop that you rarely encounter another car, but when you do, you have next to no reaction time. So you can only hope that you're fully on your side of the road, because you have to really slow down and carefully squeeze past each other. The road's very narrow. So obviously this situation would happen much more frequently if there were 22 additional vehicles traveling that way regularly. When I'm backing out of my driveway or pulling into my driveway, are the drivers coming up the hill from Bellwood Drive going to be able to see my car before it's too late to stop? I'm wondering what happens when a child is walking to the bus stop, passes by my house and over the crest of the hill and starts down the other side, and then becomes invisible to a driver coming up from the other way. What happens when two cars are climbing the hill from opposite directions and there's a child in the road? There's just nowhere to go. So my feeling is the Woodcrest Road loop was not designed to safely handle the volume of traffic that this new subdivision would generate, and the lack of visibility is a major concern to me. In closing, I would also ask that you consider that in fiscal 1998, there were 24 new single-family homes built in Cape Elizabeth. This project would add 13 new homes, which represents 50% of the new homes in the entire town at last year's rate. I feel that a community impact study ought to be required for this project, and I ask that the applicant's request for a waiver not be granted. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mill.
Good evening. I'm Andrew Howe. I live at 20 Orchid Road, which is, as we've already heard, is sort of the hypotenuse of the Woodcrest loop, if you will, opposite the subdivision across Woodcrest. As other speakers have done, I'd like to continue on the traffic mode. I think we've heard quite a bit about the traffic on Woodcrest. I would only offer, in addition to that, that as you noticed during the site walk this weekend, there were quite a number of cars parked alongside the road. This is a very common occurrence in this neighborhood because, quite frankly, as Mr. Stevens pointed out, the lots are very small, driveways are short, and many of us don't have garages. So to free up space for activities during the day, cars are often parked on the side of the road. As we stood there at the corner, the proposed intersection on Woodcrest and the new proposed road, there were a couple of cars parked right there next to us, and we just happened to be lucky, I think, with 20 people milling about in the street, that nobody did come up over the other side on the right-hand side of the road and not have any room to go. Imagine if there were several more cars parked alongside the road and an additional 20 or so cars wanting to exit and enter onto Bellwood Road. I'd also like to bring up the point that Orchid Road itself has a very hazardous intersection on Oakhurst. It's where the school bus stop is for a large number of houses in the area. But there is, in addition to that, quite a steep drop down to the Orchid intersection there from the Shore Road end. And quite often, cars travel at an excessive rate of speed over the hill, down in that little dip past the sewer pumping station and up to Mitchell. Many of us in the neighborhood avoid using that intersection to enter and exit Orchid. We will go around through the other streets in the area so that we don't have to put ourselves at risk pulling out onto Oakhurst to head towards the Shore Road end of town, Shore Road end of Oakhurst, because it is a scary intersection. And if the visibility is off, if snow is falling or rain is falling, or there's a lot of traffic in the area, it's much safer to go around to the other end of Orchid and exit onto Oakhurst on that side. So not only do we have a dangerous intersection proposed here for the new road, we also have an existing questionable intersection at Orchid and Oakhurst. The situation will be exacerbated by an additional number of cars traveling several times a day, to say nothing of the construction equipment, service vehicles, and so forth. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Podium is open.
Good evening. Mike O'Brien. I live in 8 Woodcrest Road, right here. I just wanted to echo all the things that were said by the concerns with the traffic on this intersection. The one thing I noticed that wasn't mentioned, besides the person who spoke on the water flow down this way, in the back of my yard here, it gets quite wet during the springtime, and I am concerned with the flow of water down the hill and into my backyard. And I don't know what the effect of putting this road in will have on that, or the additional, you know, lots and clear cutting. That is a big concern of mine. Also, I have a concern with this lot that would be granted to the town, of what, you know, what would the use be for that? What could be done with that? What could the town do with that lot once, if in fact this subdivision does go in? Because my house looks right onto that property. So I'd like you to consider the options there. But basically, the traffic is a very much concern, and I think you should really do that, the impact study. That would be very helpful. That's it.
Thank you, sir.
Good evening. My name is Marty Blair. I live at 63 Hillcrest Road, which is several blocks away from this subdivision, so it's actually not in my backyard. I'd like to object to the subdivision on, I think, four different reasons. One is that I feel the plan will destroy a significant habitat that exists there. At the sidewalk, we saw that it's heavily wooded, that there's very steep terrain. We heard a lot of evidence of birds and saw evidence of animals, a fair amount of deer scat and other tracks in there. And I think that clearing it, blasting it, and leveling it can do nothing but harm that habitat that is really quite beautiful at this point. The second reason I object is the lack of a community impact analysis. Certainly the traffic is an issue that needs to be considered. I also think that the amount of runoff that will be generated by the construction, by the roads, the lawns, the roofs, and the impact on the wetlands needs to be looked at more closely than has been done. I don't believe that the requirement for an analysis should be waived. Thirdly, I think that it's much too dense and the lot sizes are too small. When we were at the site on Saturday, Ms. O'Meara indicated that she felt that because it was an existing subdivision, that it would be very difficult to make changes that substantially impacted the lot sizes, that we were more or less stuck with what had been approved before. I think Mr. Lowry, the attorney, has offered you an alternative interpretation, and I'd like to ask you to consider that interpretation very carefully. It seemed to me that he is saying, yes, in fact, we can take another look. We are not tied by what happened 30 years ago. We can use today's information and opinions on what's appropriate for an area of that type and apply these standards, not be stuck with something that was appropriate at that time when the neighborhood looked very, very different than it does today. And finally, my fourth thing is that many things that I read, many things that I hear into conversations that I have, I'm on the board of the Land Trust, discuss the importance of the rural character of Cape Elizabeth. And I feel that our neighborhood at this point has lost a great deal of that. There aren't that many areas left that maintain our rural character. Putting in this many lots that involves essentially demolishing what exists there now will do significant damage to what we treasure so much about the Oakhurst neighborhood. So thank you very much.
My name is Paul Price. I live at 129 Oakhurst. I'm coming here this evening to pose a bit of puzzlement that I have. My field that I'm employed in is environmental engineering, and I work on a number of issues related to land use and the environment. One of the principles that I have been taught by my coworkers who are biologists is that continuity of wetlands is critical to their value. An isolated pocket of wetlands has little value if it's surrounded entirely by property sizes or restricted habitat. Much more valuable are wetlands which are directly connected to other wetlands or which serve as a bridge or a corridor facilitating the connection of different habitats. To that end, I have to say I'm very puzzled over why it was necessary in the design of the revision of this to change the access from the Hemlock Hill entrance to one off of the other side off of Orchid in order to protect some portion of a wetland which is entirely surrounded by residential development. Would be utterly isolated. And at the same time, you are going to create a series of lots and a new roadway that will further carve up what is a, if not a wholly contiguous, Oakhurst Road does cross it. You still have something that is at least allows some connection between wetlands that exist in forest areas that exist above Oakhurst Road to the very large and extensive wetlands that support a wide variety of species below Oakhurst. It seems to me that clearly the value to sustaining wildlife in the area makes the lower wetland far more important than the upper wetland. As a result, it appears to me to be a little nonsensical to change the development in a way that many people find to be adverse for the sake of protecting a small wetland and yet at the same time doing damage to a far more valuable one, sort of an ecological straining at gnats and swallowing camels. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Before I close the public hearing, I'd like to strongly suggest to those of you who didn't speak this evening, and those of you who did, and those that may be listening at home, that you correspond with your town planner's office. It always helps members of the planning board if we can review all this in writing. We all take notes at public hearings, but if you would like to submit your comments tonight in writing, and those of you who didn't speak, feel free to do so also, to our town planning office. Copies will be distributed to us. And so if you have any information whatsoever that you think would be helpful to us in making our decisions, please work through our town planner, your town planner, and we'll get that information. Hearing no further comments, I will close the public hearing. At this time, I'd like to offer the applicant and their staff an opportunity to address some of the concerns that were raised this evening.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll try to be as brief as I can through these. If I could start, I think drainage would be a good place to start. When we started this whole project, we're looking at this parcel, Drainage was, of course, a concern to us, as it is on every project. And what we did was we spent a considerable amount of time looking at drainage, and this included everything from contacting the Portland Water District, who maintains the sewer in this area. The applicant has obtained a letter of capacity from them for conveying the wastewater. We also took time to meet with the Public Works Director and the town engineer before the submittal. In fact, we originally had hoped to submit a month earlier, but decided it was best to wait to make sure we could look into drainage and develop an appropriate design. In doing so, we did look at the Cape Woods project. We did research the plans in the town office. We had discussions with the town engineer. In fact, there was a town engineer and one of our engineers from our office drove around and looked at the area. So we tried very hard to develop a design responsive to the site. The problem, my understanding of the problem with the pump station, when it does occur, is during large rain events, and I believe the October rain event was a significant rain amount, and I'm going to say over 10 inches is my understanding. And that rain event, the problem was INI, infiltration and inflow into the sewer system. That is unrelated to our project. We're talking about introducing just sewerage from these individual homes, not additional stormwater or INI into that. So we did look into that. We asked the questions on that. That was of importance to us, too. The culvert crossing at Oakhurst Road, we did also spend some time looking at that. We analyzed it both analytically and also spoke with the Public Works Director, town engineer, looking at the area so that we could appropriately assess it both analytically and from a practical standpoint. The result was a request to replace that culvert. Now, the culvert was 16 inches. We're putting in a 15-inch culvert. And we're also creating some wetland down on this end. This upland area will be excavated to create additional storage for stormwater detention. That will result in mitigating the increase in runoff from the site, providing some additional storage. The culvert, replacing that culvert, going to the 15-inch, the 15-inch actually has better flow characteristics than that older culvert. And in fact, that's one reason why we've been requested to remove that culvert and replace it. So the town is actually going to provide the new culvert, and the applicant will install it, will insulate it to try to help minimize any frost heave associated with it. So these were very important aspects for us, and we spent a fair amount of time, actually a lot of time, before even coming to the board to look at each and every one of these. This project started back in June when I first walked it. We came to the planning board for some workshops and have spent considerable time looking at each of these details. Joel, the applicant, has also spent considerable time looking at how each of these lots would be developed. The applicant, in fact, he went to the point, and I have some pictures here, where he's driven around town, and he took a number of photographs of other houses built on sloped land. The intent is to build the houses to fit to the land. He is going to build the houses himself as package deals for this. We also developed a specific grading plan for the site. Now, when I say specific grading plan, we wanted to make sure that each of the lots had a suitable building window that a house could go on. The applicant would like to remain creative when he goes to build the houses to try to preserve as much as he can of the landscape and develop a design that fits in with it. Fitzpatrick Associates has done a number of developments in the Cape Elizabeth area, and I think you've all seen some of the houses that he does. And if maybe what I could do is give these to Maureen if she would like to pass them out to the board. Again, they are photographs of other houses in the area that Joel has taken pictures of in his whole assessment of developing on this parcel. The site-specific grading plan was done for another purpose, too, was to make sure that we could maintain 25-foot buffers adjacent to wetlands and the stream area, and also to develop a plan with erosion and sedimentation control specifics during construction. If I could move on, Mr. Lowry presented, had a letter, and he discussed about the lot size and those issues. And I believe there was a fair amount of time and some correspondence between the town's attorney and the applicant's attorney to establish the standing of this subdivision. And I know that Maureen is, I think you have recontacted the town's attorney, and I don't know if what was some follow-up, and I would not want to speak for you on that.
I did get Mr. Lowry's letter yesterday and faxed it over to our attorney and had a conversation with him. As the board is aware, the whole issue of the status of this subdivision as a legal grandfather subdivision was the first issue that was addressed. And both the applicant's attorney and the town's attorney have reviewed it and determined that it is a legal subdivision. But Mr. Lowry has provided another argument, and so I've asked the town attorney to review his letter and provide comments regarding his letter for the board's next meeting.
The other item that Mr. Lowry brought up was they had retained Bill Bray, a traffic engineer, to look at the site. I have not had an opportunity to review his letter, but I think I know the intent of the letter. Before the applicant even began the design on this project, where this intersection came out was of importance to him. We went to the steps to measure the site distance out there. We went as far as to hold a meeting with the Public Works Director and the town engineer, and the town planner also attended that meeting. The purpose of that was to look at this whole issue of this intersection before we move forward in it. We measured the site distance. The Public Works Director measured it. I came up with 135. I believe the Public Works Director had 137, and Bill Bray had 125. The ordinance requirement for this instant is a minimum of 125 feet. So no matter whose opinion you look at, the ordinance requirement is met on that. We also, the applicant, also went as far to ask the police chief to take a look at this area. And there's a letter that was submitted as part of your packet documenting his opinion on the site. And I won't repeat exactly what it is, but my understanding is, and if I could paraphrase, he didn't feel there was any problem with this intersection. So we've gone quite a ways to look at this. A lot of this was done even before we moved forward with the project to begin. So we're very sensitive to that. We wanted to take the appropriate steps to know that we met the ordinance requirements, got the police chief and the town involved before we move forward. And we believe we have accomplished that. One gentleman asked about a culvert that was behind the residence here. I think that culvert is off our property, and we have no intention of disturbing, altering, or touching that culvert. The applicant has asked for some waivers. That includes a waiver for sidewalks. We are going to build the road as far as subbase goes and width to town dimensional standards, current town dimensional standards. We're asking for the waiver of the sidewalk because this area does not have sidewalks in it. There's no connection for the sidewalks, and we want to keep the roadway similar in nature to the area. There will be landscaping, trees planted along the frontage. There's an ordinance requirement for that, and I believe it's 40 feet, every 40 feet, and the applicant has agreed to do that. It is a requirement, so he does need to do that. So we're sensitive to all of those items. The other waiver was for the community impact study. This was an approved subdivision, as we've discussed a number of times. We're actually reducing the number of lots that could have been built from additional 19 down to 13. So we are asking the board to consider that waiver. I think let me keep going here for a moment. The town land, the applicant has gone to the council for both the land and the road to get, and I'm going to be careful on the wording here, to get a conditional municipal approval for accepting the land and the town road. And I believe that happened at the last council meeting. And the intent was to make sure that the town had some interest in acquiring that land. Otherwise, we would put it back as part of one of the lots or some sort of open space. But the town does have interest in that, and that land remains offered to the town. Mr. Price, I made a note here, brought up about wetlands. Again, that was a subject that we spent a lot of time looking at. I know we came to the planning board on a couple of workshop meetings as we were beginning to look at the wetlands. And there was a lot of time spent looking at that to assess the wetland delineation, the types of wetlands out there, the wetland zoning around it. And the intent of our design is to comply as best we can with the ordinance and being responsive to the environmental aspects of the site. There's a stream that runs through the site, which comes through here. We're proposing to cross it in one location. The original road alignment would almost follow that stream, paralleling it the entire length, and it would result in a significant amount of stream impact if we stayed with the original design. It would have also resulted in obviously more wetland impact. So we believe we have looked at that carefully. Mark Hampton is here. If the board would like to hear a little bit about the wetlands, in the essence of time, I won't ask him to come up unless you have some interest in hearing from him. Yes, Nancy.
I just have a question about that stream. Is it a perennial stream or is it there all the time?
I think I'll let Mark answer that one.
Mark Hampton with Sebago Technics. It is a perennial stream, which is defined. The state doesn't define the difference anymore between perennial and intermittent streams. Intermittent streams are seasonal streams that dry up during the dry season that would run normally during the months of October through the spring. This would be considered a perennial stream in that it does have base flow throughout the year.
I don't need to ask this of you, but when you go in to harvest the trees, are you going to build a stream crossing? You have to, don't you?
Yes, we do. We have picked the location of the road that offers the least impact to the stream crossing. That stream crossing does require that we obtain a permit by rule through the DEP for that crossing. The applicant has filed that with the state. I believe it was filed a few weeks ago. We do know we need to do that. And so the intent was to pick the location that had the least impact, both wetlands and stream, for doing that. In fact, if we had gone down the entire length of the stream, it would be looked at much more in depth by the state. It wouldn't have qualified by a permit by rule at that point. They get very sensitive about disturbing great segments of streams other than crossings as defined in their permit by rule procedures. And I don't want to say any more than that unless Mark needs to.
Are you going to build a little bridge over it or put a culvert underneath the road?
It would be a culvert underneath the road. I believe it's a 30-inch culvert.
So that the flow won't be interrupted when it's flowing.
I'm sorry.
So that the flow won't be interrupted.
That's correct.
If it's flowing.
Yes, that's correct. Mm-hmm. Yes. Kelly Fitzpatrick would like to add a few closing words, if that would be okay with the board on behalf of the applicant. Before I do that, I would ask that if it's appropriate that the board consider moving on to the next meeting to consider the project for approval. We will be filing to address the specifics that were in the town engineer's review letter. And again, those were detail items. And he was very helpful through this whole design process. We involved him at the front end. And we will file that information back to the town engineer, so that's all addressed prior to coming to the next meeting. So with that said, thank you for listening to me, and Kelly Fitzpatrick would like to add a few closing words. We're certainly available if the board has questions. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Kelly Fitzpatrick, Joel's wife and also business partner. And I just wanted to let the board know that I am in the office most of the time and do answer most of the telephone calls. And we have had a tremendous response in favor of this project as well from people who would love to live in a development such as this. You know, in this price range, in a neighborhood atmosphere, it's hard to find in this town. And I have a list of 40 or so people who are, you know, who want to be kept informed and who are anxiously awaiting word of this. And I also wanted to let you know that we have also had a tremendous response from people in the Oakhurst area themselves that love the area, and including Orchid Road, who are interested in, you know, possibly a building package in this new subdivision. So I just thought maybe I would like to make you aware of that. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I could quickly, I checked my plans that I have here. It's a 24-inch culvert, not a 30-inch. I just wanted to make sure it was correct for the record.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We are beginning to infringe on the next item on the agenda's time, but I'd like to allow the board to ask any questions or comments at this time. Mr. Emery.
Mr. Chairman, obviously we're not going to come to a decision this evening, but because so many of the, I guess, immediate abutters and people from the neighborhood are here this evening, as the chairman said earlier, we always appreciate when the public comes forward. From my estimation and from my vantage point, this was what I would call a two-thirds of a sweater public hearing. What you don't know is that there was a sweater being knit in the front row. We have, I think, with this project, a classic case of personal property rights, a pre-existing subdivision, and a concern that's constantly raised both in this community and other communities is the issue of preservation of neighborhood. Quite honestly, from the description of many of the existing residents of the abutting neighborhood, as they described their neighborhood, it sounded like they were living in quite dangerous situation. But I also live in a similar neighborhood on this side of town, so well, on the same side of town, and I'm very familiar with the notion of kids playing in the street. Ours was a through street, but there was so little traffic on it, and there are certainly many more houses than in this immediate neighborhood, that one gets very one doesn't worry about one's children. One can look out the window and see what the children are doing in the street, and it makes for a great opportunity for kids to mix from different houses in a way that planners and landscape architects and sociologists like to see neighborhoods respond. There were several neighbors who raised the question, and one of the people speaking this evening, I believe Mr. O'Brien and others, perhaps Mrs. Stevens, raised the issue of environmental or visual impact on the neighborhood. And I spoke up a little bit at the site walk and asked, what's the difference between the view that you're describing with the future development versus the view that you now share across the street if someone looks out the back of their house and sees the house across the street? I think one of the major differences is that anyone who lives on the perimeter of a wooded piece of property in Cape Elizabeth gets very used to that wood being undeveloped. It's certainly, there's just plenty of birds in every neighborhood in Cape Elizabeth almost. If you live next to even deeper woods and less developed areas, you get very used to that. But on the other hand, and as we continually say today, if you enjoy the view from your house, you better be sure you own it or you have some sort of a view easement over it. And I think as the planner described at the site walk, all of the efforts that the planning board and others in the community have put forth to do things like visual easements, vista control, have not been acceptable to the residents of Cape Elizabeth and or to the town council. And as I said at the site walk, I guess my, as I review this application, I have concerns about, at least as indicated in the grading plan, the amount of trees that are proposed to be removed. I'm not convinced that they all have to be removed for a couple of reasons. I think that the grading should occur within the building setback lines, at least along the side yards, not cross the common property lines. And that would be an example if Mr. Fitzpatrick were building on one lot and happened to sell. I know he's not intending to do this, but if he were to happen to sell an adjacent lot or a lot were sold far into the future, I think the person who owned the first house would be quite disturbed to find grading going on across their property line. So I think it would only be best practice and really help to preserve the characters as much of the trees could be preserved as possible. Keeping in mind, as all of us know who live in some of these neighborhoods that were built in the 60s, we are now cutting down trees that were preserved in the 60s because a lot of them are red maples and they're rotting out. They were kept very close to the houses, so we have problems with mildew on the roofs and those types of issues. So there is some transition that continues to take place in many neighborhoods. I think the one thing that the board will have to wrestle with, certainly the way I will evaluate this project, I'm looking very eagerly toward this issue of lot size. This is quite a new twist and one that's caught me quite by surprise, if in case Mr. Lorry's interpretation is correct. With respect to community impact, I think the applicant makes a valid argument that this project was approved many, many years ago, long before many of us may have even lived in the houses that we're in this neighborhood and other neighborhoods. When the sewer system was approved, it's my understanding it was approved in the north end of town to allow for infill development. So presumably those lots are already dealt with. I think the issue with stormwater runoff is the proof is in the pudding. If the abutters, without the abutters having to go to enormous expense, but I think the applicant has to demonstrate to the planning board and meet our standards and demonstrate that they are going to handle the stormwater runoff adequately. Traffic, I think, is an issue. We've heard from understand that Bill Bray doesn't believe there's adequate site distance. It was my first question when I came to the top of the rise, and I raised it to the applicant, what's the site distance to the right, because it certainly, even if it is adequate, it seems to be problematic. And it seems to be problematic even as the neighborhood, the neighbors were describing the situation today. If this project weren't developed, but two cars were coming from opposing distances and there was a child playing over the hill, there seems to be a safety issue there today. Does it make sense to make a one-way loop out of that cul-de-sac so that at least if this road is developed, one always knows which way to look, presumably? And I know that's an issue for people outside the immediate neighborhood. But I think I put a lot of emphasis on the fact that this is a previously approved subdivision. I think the applicant has to demonstrate that as much of the trees are going to be preserved as possible. And I mean, that has to be demonstrated on the plan. It can be very easily demonstrated by simply indicating where the limits of grading are. Some of the best houses and some of the greatest design architecturally in all of the world, and certainly in this country and in the Northeast, comes with very difficult sites. This isn't an area of the country that would probably end up with a house like Falling Water that Frank Lloyd Wright did, but that site is a clear indication that every time one tries to develop a standard to apply for all of the world is not soft or flat, and creative people can certainly deal with problematic sites, I think, in a very interesting way. And that's not to say there may not be people, as there was in other neighborhoods in town, who took a very interesting and ledgy site and virtually tried to blast it flat to put in a just a very flat house. So I think that's a very important part of this application, this overall grading plan. A question that I have is the issue of in walking the site, as someone had mentioned, there's a lot of ups and downs in the property. And if one looks at the profile and the grading plan of the road is going to come to a low point and then it's going to have a constant slope to the high point of the property. There's no intermediate rises or falls in that road, and it may be because of the town standards requires that, I don't know, but that would be something that if that helps the grading, if it adds more interest and can somehow reduce the impact on the ledge, that would be another item I think would be interesting to see. In the event that the applicant does not feel comfortable with limiting the clearing between the lots, I would request that the applicant provide a buffer plan or some other way of either through the developer or through constraints on each lot as they're developed, that appropriate buffer would be planted between the house lots. And I think if there's special attention that needs to be made between the views from the back of the residence and the existing neighborhood to the proposed development, that should be addressed, and as well as the issue of the slope on the fill on the downhill side. If nothing else, certainly the issue of people who live on the low side of the of streets inevitably end up having flooded basements and those sorts of things. And as long as the applicant can make that issue, can make us comfortable with that issue. The issue of habitat and so forth, I have to look at the town's ordinances. The town has done a comprehensive plan. It has looked at the critical areas in town. The DEP evaluates those areas whenever there's a larger project, perhaps, than this. But that's all part of this. And for each of us that enjoys the rural character, we should each look within our own neighborhoods and look at the rural character within our own neighborhoods. Time and time again, this planning board gets applications for new subdivisions that are in areas that are zoned for subdivision, that if when one buys a house knows that the land next door is zoned for something, it's at least a good idea to check, make sure you're not in an industrial area. And oftentimes the newer standards are more strict than the conditions under which people are currently living. That is, the older lots tend to be smaller, the street standards tend to be less stringent, the older street standards. So at this point, with respect to the impact on the neighborhood, I think the older lots may actually be, the situation in the existing neighborhood may be more dangerous than the proposed neighborhood. But I'm going to put a lot of emphasis on the fact that this is a previously approved subdivision. But I heard a lot of issues here tonight, and I think it's really up to the applicant to be sure that the planning board is satisfied that all those are met. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Emery. Mr. Wilcox.
Yes, I'd like to make a couple of observations and then direct a couple of questions to the applicant. The developments that we've seen tonight in terms of new information, I'm kind of looking forward to the further information that we'll be getting next month. The status of the subdivision and the lots, which was brought to our attention that the subdivision ordinance says that lots shall conform to the zoning ordinance, is an interesting twist and an interesting logic. However, if the zoning ordinance includes specific instructions on how to develop lots of record that are not up to the same size as the existing ordinance, it doesn't take a great deal of interpretation to also see that you can conform to the zoning ordinance with a lot that doesn't meet current standards by following that section of the zoning ordinance. So I'd be interested in seeing what the town attorney's reaction to that argument is. I'd also be interested perhaps in seeing what the information on the vertical site distance is on the curves, because that is something that seemed to me at first to be the most major concern here in terms of traffic flow and the sort of design of the plan of the subdivision and where houses are located. That intersection looks like any of dozens of intersections around town, indeed very similar to the intersection over on Orchid Road that just sort of spins off from the central loop. And we're not talking about, in terms of by comparing the new houses to the existing houses, a significant percentage of new houses with regard to the overall subdivision. But vertical site distance is something that's very important in terms of cars coming over the hill and catching you by surprise when you're there, but the reference that was presented of there needing to be at least 250 feet there when one turns to the zoning ordinance and sees that our zoning ordinance says that that type of intersection needs 125 to 150 feet, I see that we really need to look carefully at this new information that's been submitted. I have a question for the applicant, and that has to do with The difficulties of building, which were brought to our attention, that we all noticed on the site walk, and that has to do with the area on the north side of the road, particularly in the locations of Lot 5 and 6. The final design, which shows houses with daylight basements on the north, appears convincing on paper that it could work, that you could have daylight basements. But I was wondering if someone might be able to sort of speak a little bit to what would happen before those two houses were built. Presumably the road gets built first. There's a section or two in the road where there are fairly high fills, but one probably wouldn't completely fill those lots also prior to those houses being built. And beyond the sort of generic, what do you do about side slopes, I was wondering if the applicant could address that or perhaps even consider showing us some road sections next month in that area. Whatever, if there are some plans on how to deal with it, if you could sort of tell us what your intent is. Sure, come on up.
You're exactly right. The road is the first element that goes in before any of the houses are built. And in this case, what will happen is when they go in, they will clear the areas necessary to construct the roadway only initially. And that would include clearing the areas suitable for grading appropriate side slopes to stabilize the roadway through the site. There are obviously areas of cuts and fills and undulating terrain as you go up through the site. So initially, the road would be constructed so that you had stable side slopes and cleared for the roadway construction. And we could certainly provide a typical cross-section of what that might look like just for the roadway, if that would be appropriate.
I guess in a little bit more detail, this is the area in between Lot 5 and Lot 6 is probably the largest area of open clearing. Everything else seems to be fairly tight to the road or tight to the proposed houses. Mm-hmm. Is there a desire on the applicant's part to develop a large lawn on the east side of Lot 5? Or if you were to find significant trees in there and the ability to keep some existing trees in there, is that something you could consider?
Sure. We certainly recognize that. And as when we developed the grading plan, one of the applicants, and I'll let him speak here in a minute to that because he has some very specific ideas.
Okay.
One of the things that Joel has been interested in doing from the very beginning is when they go up in through there, the grading plan we did was simply a representation to know that we could build houses in these envelopes, that we could fit the size of house with a garage that the applicant would like to build. Beyond that, the applicant certainly wants to try to work as best he can with the terrain, and he's done that on other projects. And when I say that, that means looking at where he might be able to save some trees, where there might be some ledge cuts that he might be able to incorporate into the landscaping on that. And we actually integrated that. That became a note on our grading plan because he didn't want to be tied to having to do it this way, because he really doesn't want to do it this way. He wants to be able to know that he has building envelopes, then work with the houses and the designs for each of the lots. That's important to Joel, and I'll let him talk for a minute on that. He can speak to that with even more passion than I can, so I'll let Joel talk.
My name is Joel Fitzpatrick. I'm the developer of this property. When I first looked at this property 2 years ago, there was a lot of different ideas on different designs and ways we were going to approach this. We did decide to do the subdivision like it originally was designed, and once we've decided that we were going to do that, we did look at this whole side, thinking that that was going to be the most challenging area to develop. When I saw Owen's grading plan, I just wanted to make sure he was had a note in there that those were tentative grading plans, because I look at this and I see a beautiful subdivision. I see, you know, hills and stone and you know, rock gardens with the ledge and cuts. Sheer cuts in the ledge to keep his natural stone walls, that kind of thing. I do this for a living, so I can picture this, you know, fairly easily. These lots here, 5, 6, and 7, this is I'm most concerned about, I guess, as far as design goes. I look at those as no problem, because this is what I do. I do a lot of designing myself, and I design to these types of lots. And we will be filling in the front yard, stepping down the sides, and daylighting the rear, which really creates an area where I don't have to fill much of the backyard at all. I look at this like it's going to be an easy procedure on my part, but I can see where people who don't do this for a living and don't know, you know, much about the building procedure and design procedure, where it would look a little, you know, difficult. I would like to say one thing about the safety issue. I know there's a large safety issue here, and that is something that's been on my mind right from the start. We did have that meeting at the intersection with the town engineer and my engineer and town planner and all, you know, people involved. We have been talking, like my wife said, to people who are interested in buying these properties. Every one of them are families. Every one of them has kids. I mean, I can literally say that every single one of them has families. They all have kids. They're all going to have kids walking down the end of the street. They're all going to have kids walking to the neighbors' homes. They're going to have the exact same concerns everybody else has, and that's safety. I'm going to have those safety concerns throughout construction. We do have, in some of the larger projects we do send out letters to the subcontractors and suppliers, and I will be sending out a monthly letter to them voicing my concern about safety and speed during construction. And if we find anybody taking advantage of that, I will make sure that that's handled. Thank you.
Mr. Wilcox.
I have one more item that I think perhaps for the board to discuss amongst itself before the applicant leaves this evening.